right. Hey, guys. Welcome to the Hollywood Dreams podcast. This is Santi, your host, along with my other host, Dave. How are you, Dave?
I'm good, Santi. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing great, man. And now that I'm talking with you guys, even better. So tonight we got one hell of a guest. He's the drummer for a lot of bands. All of our listeners, I'm sure, like a lot. So we are really excited to have you here. Anthony, welcome to the show.
Good to be here. How you guys doing?
Good, man.
Doing great.
Great to have you.
So how's the weather in Las Vegas?
Surprisingly enough, it's cold.
Oh. Okay.
But I guess when it's winter, it gets really cold. I have to ask,
what is really cold? What is really cold?
I think 40s and 50s.
Okay.
I mean, which is because it's Las Vegas, so you think 100 and, you know, umpteen million degrees, you know, how could it get that cold? But it actually does, so.
Yeah, that's a little chilly. I'm in Ohio, so it's maybe a few degrees cooler than that.
Oh, right now. Where in Ohio are you at?
I am in Lodi, but I'm from Cleveland, and not too far out from Cleveland. Lodi is about maybe 45 minutes south of Cleveland.
Howard, as I lived in Ohio when I went off the grid for 15 years.
Wow. Where did you live?
I lived outside of Akron.
Oh, yeah, you're not far from me.
Yeah, right. Wow. Lodi, the outlets are out that way.
Yes. Yeah, they're right, literally the like 2 minutes from me.
Right, with the train.
Not much in there anymore. Yeah, very cool.
Yeah.
So I'm a bit far away from you guys. I'm in Buenos Aires, Argentina. So I only know Lodi from that Creedence song. I don't know.
Well, that's Lodi, California. That's not okay. I mean, I guess we could say it's Lodi, Ohio, but it's all right.
Right. I always wondered what the weather's like there now, where you're at.
Today's been particularly hot, so it's around 85, close to 90.
Wow.
Yeah.
One episode we recorded, he recorded next to his mom's swimming pool. That was...
Oh, how cool is that?
I'm sitting here in a snowstorm, that, you know.
Yeah, but it was like the decline of Western civilization with that Chris Holmes scene.
Yeah. Some friend, right?
Yeah. Okay, so Anthony, what have you been up to lately? I know you've got a new band, Generation Landslide.
I do. It's been in the making probably for close to 20 years, 30 years. It kind of started at the early 90s. And at the time, I was doing the Kiss tribute band, Cold Gin. And I thought I would put together an original band again. And I started it, and I started to get the members and started doing the songs, and just wasn't meant to be and had to let it go. So 30 years later, I decided to do it again and tried to contact some of the same people. Was fortunate to get one of the two people that I had before. Okay. And got another friend of mine who I used to play in another cover band in Ohio, of all things, and I got him on board and found a guitar player that I had known from the old days back in Las Vegas, and just decided to put this thing together and see what happens. So far, it's about a year into it, and the record comes out next Friday.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
As a matter of fact, yeah.
That's awesome. So you got singles out already?
Yeah, we have two singles out. We put one out in February called Feel the Sensation. Then I believe we put another one out, Little Miss Lonely, in July, I think it was. Yeah.
And then I gotta check that out. Yeah.
Yeah. So those are both out. And we're gonna try to do a third one for Love and Pain as the ballad. So we're gonna do one of those probably next week.
Awesome. Who are you guys working with on this album? Or did you produce it yourself?
I did it myself. Yeah. As a matter of fact, it was all engineered and recorded in LA. Hmm. but I produced it myself. I brought it here to Las Vegas, finished it all up. And I just, you know, figured, well, you're going to, you know, do good by myself or I'm going to drown. So it's all on me this time. I, you know, I don't have anybody from the Cold Sweat guys to help me out.
Yeah. Well, you got us. We will promote it and whatever we can on our social media. We got you covered.
Awesome. Yeah, that's definitely.
Appreciate it. That's awesome.
Yeah. We'll include some links on the description of the video to your singles. And yeah, we will definitely promote that. So are you doing any videos as well for any other songs? Or
I think we're just going to do a video for Love and Pain will be the third one that we're going to do next week. Yeah. So awesome. I don't know how many more after that. If nobody buys it, then it's, you know, kind of a waste.
Yeah, well, so you're doing physical copies as well, not only streaming.
Right. And the physical copy, the funny thing is I actually have.
Oh, nice.
Oh, wow. A little hard to see it. But there's the actual physical copy of the CD that comes out next Friday. So.
And how many tracks you guys have on it?
10.
10 tracks? Cool.
Yep, 10 songs on it. And most of it's straight ahead, hard rock. There's a couple of what I call, I'm old school. I'm an old guy. So I go back to stuff like Beatles and Paul McCartney and, you know, I don't know if you guys remember, you probably do, Mr. Biggs, Be Here, you know, whatever that, To Be With You. And
yeah.
There's a couple of those songs on there where it's just,
oh, okay.
Sit around a campfire and, you know, just take a break for 5 minutes and, you know, so.
Nice. I mean, that sounds right up my alley. So I'll be checking that out for sure.
Yeah, no doubt.
Awesome.
I'm probably closer to your age, Anthony, than our buddy Santi here.
But don't put that around.
So, when you think we don't remember.
Look young. Like those guys in the video I see behind you.
Yeah.
Who the hell are those guys anyway?
Hey, sometime that Love and Pain video is going to be playing on that big screen. So,
yeah, that would be great. Actually, yeah,
I'll make sure of it. I'll have it out here.
So you're playing in shows to promote the album, right? I know you got some shows coming up.
Yeah, well, it's the end of the year, so we can't do too much, but we have one coming up, as a matter of fact, next Friday. We've got a show. It's funny that the show we're doing is, I play in a couple of other cover bands. Just to have fun, I play drums in one, I play guitar in another, and just to make, you know, money and just have fun and stuff. So my original band, Generation Landslide, is going to open up for one of the cover bands that I'm in. So I get to play guitar first, and then my drums will already be set up, and I just jump behind the drums and start hanging away and playing a bunch of cover songs. So it's
just
be
Yeah, just a regular Dick Van Dyke, man.
Well, I don't know about that, but I try. Whatever, you know, have instrument, will travel. It's always been my motto, so.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I mean, that's cool. What's the hangout places now in Las Vegas? Where are you playing?
It's a place, oddly enough, when we were growing up, because I'm from here, they had way different types of places. Now, in areas that didn't used to have a lot of activity, now have activity, like a small city called Henderson. Mm-hmm. Henderson now all of a sudden has become this big, you know, place where they have like a one street called Water Street, and it has just a bunch of, you know, casinos and bars and music goes on, and, you know, so they're really trying to build it up. So a lot of bands play there. So we play there a lot. We play in Boulder City, which is another outskirts of Las Vegas. Pahrump, I don't know if anybody's ever even heard of Pahrump. That's just this thing in the desert that, you know, there's mountains on the entrance and there's mountains at the exit. And it's, nobody knows where it is. You just drive to it in one road and that's it.
Is the venue there in the mountains?
Yeah, it's like right in the center of town, you know. Once you get over the mountains, all of a sudden you see a little bit of lights and you go, oh, that's probably where the bands play. Next to another casino. Everybody, you know, everywhere you go, there's casinos.
That makes sense, though.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, well.
Especially if you don't know the town, you get lost. Like, well, there's a casino. Guess I'm right.
Well, the thing is with all the lights, you know, with the gazillions of lights, you can't miss it, you know.
Yeah.
And underneath those lights are all the casinos.
Man.
Yeah. So it's fun. It's cool. I left here when I was younger, and then I came back just like 2 or 3 years ago, and I hadn't been here for a long time, and it's just so different to me that, you know,
right.
It's still a shock for me. That's all.
Also, in what way is it different?
Because everything became huge. Like, right. Not only huge, it just became corporate. So when I was growing up, I grew up here in the mid-70s on. And back then, this was a place that nobody really knew about unless you lived there, and everybody loved it, and it was great. Now, there's freeways going all the way around that never existed before, and all the little hotels, you know, the Strip had all really cool neon lights, and it was just, wow, this is cool and exciting. Now it looks like downtown Hong Kong or town Taiwan, you know, because the buildings are, you know, million feet high and they're all on top of each other, and
right,
it's just different for me. I'm not used to it, so yeah, but that's okay.
It's kind of lost that magic, huh?
For me it did. For everybody else loves it, you know, and I get it. I understand it, but I'm just used to an old school, old style, you know, growing up here, you know. But that's okay.
It is.
You have those memories. That's what's good.
Yeah.
I do. You know, it is. Yeah, I actually do. So I don't want to lose those. I'll just keep those.
Yeah. Hold on to them as long as you can.
Right.
Okay. So talking about the past, let's talk about how you got started drumming. What made you got into music?
Actually, I started in high school, and oddly enough, I was good friends with Mark Slaughter from the band Slaughter before Slaughter, and him and I used to just pal around together, and we used to hang around with these guys that were like a year older than us, and they would rehearse, and we would go watch them play, and we would be like, wow, man, this is pretty cool. Man, I'm going to learn how to play one of these instruments, and that's what we did. And basically, Mark Slaughter and I just started learning how to play, and we put together a band called Xcursion.
Yeah.
And back then, like I said, Las Vegas was different. You know, everybody knew everybody else, and that band, you know, was pretty big for that time. So that's what pretty much got me started. I was a big fan of, obviously, like everybody else, Led Zeppelin and Rush and Kiss and, you know, all of those early to mid 70s bands, you know, so I just wanted to be like, wow, one of them, you know, and that was it. And I just started to play and just.
So was there a big rock scene in Vegas?
There was.
Around that time?
Yeah, there was a huge rock scene at that time. I mean, there was like, everybody was trying to be in bands, and everybody was, you know, at that time. And I know this sounds crazy or weird, but at that time, not that they didn't card people, but, you know, you had to be 18 years old to get in, you know, to clubs and bars then, and then 21, you know, how it progressed.
Right.
When we were doing this at the late 70s, early 80s, this was still that gray area of, like, being able to, like, we opened up for Joe Perry Project, you know, at, like, the Troubadour, which was a big place, you know, for Las Vegas back in the late 70s, early 80s. But we were underage. We weren't even 21. But But because we were in a popular band, you know, they said, oh, you bring a bunch of people in. So, yeah, we'll put you on that show. And, you know, we would do stuff like that. When there wasn't a place to play, we would organize what we used to call keg parties. Back in the old days, there would be somebody, you know, I don't know if you've ever seen any of those movies where, hey, man, go get us a couple of kegs and then we'll meet you out at blah, blah, blah. Well, that's what we did. So Xcursion would be the featured band. We'd have a couple guys go get a couple of kegs. We'd go out to the desert, get a generator with power, you know, charge a couple of bucks, and the, half the town, you know, would show up to the desert and just listen to music and drink. And it was a great time. Yeah, that's what we did as Mark and I were going through high school and, you know, a little further than that. So
yeah,
it was good times.
What was the feeling you got when you heard Mark's voice for the first time?
It was fine for me because I to everybody else, they didn't know what he sounded like. I had already had known what he sounded like because I grew up with him. So what we tried to be was we tried to be patterned after Triumph. I don't know if you guys remember Triumph, where
the
drummer sang and the guitar player sang. The guitar player had the high voice. The drummer had the, you know, medium, you know, voice. Mm-hmm. That's how we patterned ourselves to do that. And then, so I was used to him singing way up high and doing all that, you know, Rick and Steve Perry and all that stuff. And it was great, you know, because we could harmonize with each other and balance each other. So it was really cool. And then it just, that became his style. That became his, you know, sound. And he just continued it from there, like in Vinnie Vincent and then, you know, into Slaughter. So it was cool. Yeah.
Very cool. So that's the stuff I like to hear, those little things that you probably don't. Do you talk about that a lot? Do you get a lot of that in interviews?
A little bit. Yeah. A little bit. I mean, some of the behind the, you know, scene stuff is so much cooler to talk about and stuff because, you know, just the experience, not the same stuff. Everybody, you know, my life has been what I would call the almost made it life, but I got a lot of things, you know, in that course of, you know, from early 80s all the way through. I met a lot of people and did a lot of things, but I never, you know, I was that almost, oh, you almost, you know, Cold Sweat and almost, you know.
Yeah.
But I still got to feel things and experience a lot of stuff, so it was really cool getting to talk about those things, you know, behind the scenes with Ronnie James Dio or Eddie Van Halen or the Kiss guys or, you know, those kinds of things. So those were good times for me, actually.
Yeah, that's the stuff we like to hear on here.
I think the definition of what constitutes making it or not making it. I always like to think that it's not like sale. It's not a sales thing or a fame. I don't know. Having some 30 plus years later, having someone show interest in your music, I think that's making it. And having recorded stuff, having your music out in the world for people to hear, and I think that's making it. I don't know. It's not just selling millions of records or selling out arenas or anything. You don't have to be Motley Crue to make it. I don't think. Yeah.
Yeah, like to me and Santi as fans of the genre, and we love it on different levels. You know, I'm a few years older, so I kind of lived through it where Santi did not. You know, he kind of picked up on it later, but to be able to sit here for us and talk to you all these years later, you know, you definitely made it.
Right?
You definitely made it in our eyes.
And finally, with actually a product of something that I actually did, you know, myself, to me is very, very gratifying after the 30-something year journey that I've had, you know. Yeah.
Right. So yeah.
It's kind of like topping of the Christmas tree.
Yeah, right. Exactly. So now I can at least look and go, okay, well, whether it's my last hurrah or not, at least I'm going out with a bang again, you know, to go, okay, I did this, this, this. I did this, this, this. I almost did this, this, this. I tried this, this. Now here I am with one thing that says, you know, this is my product, my name on it, my, you know, whatever you want to call it. And
yeah,
let's just hope for the best. And is that success? I don't know. You know,
it is in my opinion, it is. I mean,
yeah, I agree.
Definitely. Yeah.
Yeah.
So going back to the Xcursion album, I love the album cover. It's so early 80s heavy metal with all the white how did you guys record an EP and a full album? How did that happen? Did you guys got interest from a label?
We just, at the time, we thought, well, we're just developing and developing, so why don't we go in and continue to keep recording? When we felt that we had something that was worth, I don't know what you call it, but at that time we thought, oh, this is the best material we got. So we decided to record an EP.
Mm.
When we did it, we started to send it out to try to get distribution on it. And back then there was a company called Green World, which got bought out by Enigma. And so they took on the record, put it out. And that's the thing with the skull on it with the, I don't know if you guys have ever seen it. And the funny thing about it is, even if people never heard the record or heard of the band, somehow or another, they've seen the cover. And I don't know why or how, but it became kind of this, you know, underground cult type of cover thing. So we did that and it sold, you know, some copies and we just kept going. And then we changed our style again. So, you know, you got to remember we were back in at end of high school. We were just kids. So on the EP, if you look at it, there's four songs and we're dressed in black and silver and all this, you know, stuff like that. And the songs are, you know, heavy and stuff like that. So we're going, okay, here we go. A year later, we decide, no, let's change it. Let's mix it up. Let's be like Angel and Triumph and all these things. And we'll all be in white and we'll all, you know, and we'll do another record. And so we did. And then the record was a little better, but it was more commercial. It was more, you know, mainstream type of stuff. And so that, then we did that. And then after that, we just kind of ran our course, if that makes any sense. You know, we thought we were going to make it and this and that. And I remember when we were near the end, a friend of mine had contacted me and said, hey, I know a band who's looking for a drummer. And I said, okay, fine. And then they told me about it and this and the other. And I thought, oh, okay, I didn't think anything about it. So it was something different than what I thought it was. So a friend of mine drives me to LA and we go to this party and I'm sitting at this party and we're having drinking and doing our thing and stuff. And I get introduced to Ozzy Osbourne. Oh, wow. And I didn't think anything about it. So I meet him, this and the other, and we start to talk and I'm thinking, what's going on here? I had no idea what was going on. The next thing I know, I get introduced to Tommy Lee. And he says, oh, don't worry about Oz. I'll take him over there if you want it. And I thought, what's going on here? Come to find out, a good friend of mine who had brought me to this party was good friends with all them. And this was at the time where Ozzy was looking for another drummer to do, I believe it would have been the Bark at the Moon album.
Right.
And recommended me. And so I went down there, whatever, and met with them and everything. And they were going to take me over to the rehearsal, and I knew Ozzy's material. He only had the two records, and I knew all the drum stuff, and they must have thought I'd be perfect for it. But then I turned around and I started to think in my head, you know, we're drinking and this and that. And I thought, no, you know what? I need to go back to Las Vegas. Let me talk it over with Mark and Al, the two guys in Xcursion. I come back. I said, can I come back down another time? Sure, we'll make arrangements. I come back, and it turns out, everybody's like, come on, man, let's just do this, man. We're going to be big. We're going to be big. Let's do our own thing. I never auditioned for Ozzy. Xcursion went on a little bit further. We ended up breaking up, and I moved to California. So that's, if I could go back 30 years, you know what I'm saying? Like, well, this now would have been 40 years. You know, maybe I would have done something different and said, look, you know how people are nowadays. You know, back then, people were loyal. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, oh, all these bands want to make it together and this and that. And nowadays, people are switching members left and right.
Yeah, and also you don't have 40 years of perspective. Back then, you didn't have that, so.
Correct. I didn't want to think, oh, it's just about me and myself. I thought, wow, I'm just, a late teenager, 18, 19, 20, 21 years old. Wow, this could be cool. We started this band together. We're going to, whatever. That's what you do. So I never went back down there. The band breaks up and I moved to L.A. And that was pretty much the end of Xcursion. And then Mark, I kept in touch with him. And he went off and got into Vinnie Vincent. And then through my path and his path, we ended up crossing again for the Cold Sweat and Slaughter thing, because those came out, at the same time.
Around the same time, yeah.
Right. So our paths crossed again, and then, but at that point, he was doing Slaughter, and I'm doing Cold Sweat, so we're doing the same thing, we're just doing two totally different, bands. So that's really where Xcursion ended. It was, it came and went, and then I moved on, and he moved on, and that was it.
So after that, you went straight to Cold Sweat, or was there anything
that
you did in the middle?
I went to LA and I tried to get in bands that I thought had potential to get deals, obviously to become something. So the first band I got in, we'd opened up for Kix. I don't know if you guys remember Kix and a couple other bands and stuff. And we thought, okay, cool. We showcase, no go. Well, I got to go, guys. I'm sorry I spent a year. I got to keep moving. Did the next band. And the next band was even bigger than that. They were in Hollywood, and we were opening up for other bands as well. And same thing. Well, it's not whatever. And then so the third band, it was the fourth band. Then I got in a third band. Same thing. It was the story of my life. It was like going, is this ever going to happen? So the third band once again had record company potential, didn't work, didn't happen. I get a phone call from Mark Ferrari saying he's putting a band together, blah 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 blah. I got recommended from Mark Slaughter, Greg Chason from Badlands, we were friends, and other people, and said, hey, try this guy out. So I tried out, got the gig, put the band together, and went through a member. And I got a friend of mine in there, and then we had a record contract, and everybody knows the story that Oney Logan gets taken away from the band from George Lynch, by George Lynch.
Right.
And so he quits the band, and we have no singer, and we have a record deal. I thought, oh man, here we go again. This is just, So we waited and we waited and we auditioned like just a ton of people. And meantime, while we're doing that and stuff, we're just writing more songs, doing more, we're just developing, and it's just, So at this point, Roy finally comes along. When we found him, we thought, oh my God, this is awesome. This is great. And we thought, okay, and I've always said this to anybody who's ever asked me. When I look back at it now, there's two things I always remembered. One, when the record came out and we had those five guys, I thought it was great. I thought the material was great. The band sounded great. The band looked great. That was the band.
Right.
On the downside, because it had taken so long, everybody has to remember the time frame that it was. That record should have come out before Slaughter, Hurricane, Warrant. There was a bunch of bands that we were supposed to come out in early 89. We would have caught the tail end of what was, you know, Guns N' Roses and all of that.
Right.
Because of what had happened to us, the album got pushed back and delayed. By the time the record came out in mid-June or so of 1990, most of the scene was already starting to change. Mm-hmm. And so on the upside, the songs were better, the record was better, the playing was better, the singing was better. On the downside, the timing was wrong.
Yeah.
And it was wrong. We were only going to last as far as we were going to last because the scene was already changing. So that was kind of the downside of it. And we lasted all the way till the end of 1990. But I'm proud of what we did. I'm proud of the record. I'm proud we opened up for everybody and anybody we could. We did a month and a half or so tour with Ronnie James Dio.
Mm-hmm.
You couldn't ask for anything, you know.
No, yeah.
More than that for an up and coming band, you know. But you know, it was what it was, and you know, I'm still proud of it because we just did two reunion shows. We did a Monsters of Rock in 2020, and then we just did a Monsters on the Mountain in 2020.
Oh yeah.
And I gotta be honest, I was just blown away that people actually even cared about the band. I mean, so
it was, and there's a lot of I mean, it's a band that at least what I see online, there's a lot of fans out there, and you I was about to buy, actually. So the album came out again in Japan this year, so I was planning on buying that because I don't have I've been trying to find, I collect vinyl, so I always wanted to have the vinyl, but it's really hard to find, so I wanted to have this.
Not an easy one to come by.
For Japan, it didn't, did it?
Sorry?
Did it come out on vinyl in Japan? It didn't, just the CD, right?
No, just the CD, but it came out on vinyl in Europe.
Right. I have a copy. What's funny about it is I have a copy on vinyl of the American release and the European release. I have both of those on vinyl. Oddly enough, they're pretty much exactly the same, except the writing, obviously, made in England, made in the USA. But
right,
But I do have the copy of it from Japan too, the CD that just came out. Yeah.
Yeah. Does that have bonus tracks or anything on it? Or is it just
the one from Japan is pretty basic.
Yeah.
The one that just came out from Universal before Japan, they did a fantastic job on it. I mean, I'm telling you what, they told the story of the band. They put all these pictures of us signing the contract to I mean, they did an unbelievable job. Whoever, you know, I don't even know who did it. I'm not sure who did it. I think I know. I think it was Dave Tedder and his company. With Mark Ferrari and stuff, I couldn't believe it. It didn't have the poster anymore. When you first got it, it had the poster of the band and the lyrics were on the back. This one has the booklet, but it has so much way better pictures and just the story of the band. It's actually really cool. I was pretty excited about it when I saw it.
I see that. That came out in 2018.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. So this reunion shows you play, was Mark playing too?
Was he what?
Was Mark playing as well on these reunion shows?
Okay. The original five guys, yeah.
Oh, nice.
That was one of the things that on the Monsters of Rock cruise and on the Monsters on the Mountain, that was one of the things that people were saying, that it was so surprising that after all these years, the same five guys were up there. Because, you know, everybody knows nowadays, you get three guys in one, you get two guys in another, you might get four out of five. And one, you know, there's,
right.
you know. But we were one of the ones that had all five guys. And so it was actually really cool. But the difference for me was the Monsters of Rock cruise, I was still coming off of being out of sight, out of mind. And they contacted me and said, hey, we're going to this and the other. Well, I was had short hair still and, you know, blah, 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 blah. 2 years later, I was able to redeem myself and at least look back normal again to be up there to play. I felt better about that one.
All right, so I have a question that requires a bit of context, so bear with me. So 15 years ago, I when internet forums were a thing, I remember finding some demos by, they were labeled as Cold Sweat demos with Owen Logan, right? And there was a song called Love Is, which went something like, love is what you made it, something like that. And I fell in love with that song. That was an amazing song. And somehow I lost those files. I lost them. I don't know, my hard drive crashed, something like that. And I could never find them again. It has been 15 years. I could never find them again. And I always wanted to know if those demos were really by Cold Sweat, if it was like a Noni Logan's thing, or was it? They weren't.
I've heard that same story before. Someone said they put out this thing that had X amount of we had done demos after we had gotten dropped from MCA. We had done four songs, a demo with Mark Ferrari, and then we did another four songs with another LA guitar player that we replaced him with called Billy DeVette. I've seen a thing where it has all those songs on it, and then it has these other ones on it, and one of them is that Love Is thing.
Okay.
We've all been asked, what is that? What are those songs? Who are those? They're not us.
We don't know what they are. There's a band called Paradise, not Paradise like the DeVette, but Paradise. That's a Canadian band that had that very same song recorded on their album that came out in 95, 96, something like that. They have that very same song. And that band featured members of the band Kick Axe. So I don't know, man. It's all so confusing. It's like a mystery, but it's a rock and roll mystery.
It is, because there was a Canadian band called that. And then there was another LA band called Paradise.
Yeah.
And one of those guys, the guitar player, was in our band after Cold Sweat, and we had changed the name to Sweat and Bullets. We had made a demo. I'm thinking if those other songs, they could be that other band that he was in before us, you know.
Okay.
So that's the only thing I can think of, because it wasn't us. I heard this before, and all five of us look and go, that's not us. I don't know why people think it's us, because it's probably labeled that.
Yeah. And it's funny, because a few weeks ago, some guy claimed to have those demos, right? So I asked him, hey, can you share that? I've been looking for that for so long. Can you share at least that song with me? And he's like, yeah, sure, man. How much money can you send me? And I'm like, fuck you. I'm not going to send you money for some old demos. Yeah. Well, that's the world we're living in.
Yeah. See, you're right.
Yeah, so, all right. So, yeah, before we started recording it, you said that there was a... if you could go back, you would change the song that you played on the video. Do you feel that other songs on the album represented more what the style and sound you were going for, other than the one of Let's Make Love Tonight?
Absolutely. I would have changed it to Cry and Shame. To me, I thought, when people heard that song, it really represented what Cold Sweat was. And I'm not saying any of the other songs were better or worse. I just felt that that particular song, if you're going to start out of the gate with something, start out with that. And the video could have still been the same. Like, I was watching the video behind Dave there, and the video could still be the same. So you have, you know, in concert and da-da-da-da-da. But just the song itself, I just think is a better representation of what Cold Sweat was. And then from there, you could do whatever you wanted after that. You could go commercial. You could do the ballad. You could do whatever it is that you want to do. But I just felt that particular song should have started everybody off on saying, here's Cold Sweat. What do you think? You know.
Right.
Yeah, and I remember, and this sounds really strange or stupid, but I always remembered the very first time I ever saw it on MTV's Headbangers Ball. And it was Ricky Rockman. Is that his name? Ricky Rockman?
Yeah.
I'll never forget when he introduced it and da, 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 da. He tried to make it, and it's not knocking him. I just felt that he thought, oh, let's make love tonight, baby. And I thought, it's Headbangers Ball. It's supposed to be badass. And we're playing a song called Let's Make Love Tonight. And it's
like a song.
You know,
yeah, sounds like some Marvin Gaye song.
Right. I felt when I watched Ricky say that, I thought, you know, it's cool as heck to be on there, but I almost felt like he was not making fun of it, but it just didn't fit or match with what was going on at the time, you know.
So yeah.
Honestly, that's what Ricky Rackman did. If he didn't like a song, or he had a problem with the song, that's what he did. He kind of did those little things to kind of poke at it, instead of just like being cool about it and being like, you know, hey, here's Cold Sweat, right, let's make love tonight, and then you move on. You know, he had to make his, and that was one thing that always annoyed me about him. And he would plug his friends all the time on that show, but you know,
well, it makes sense, yeah.
Yeah, it was like, right, come on, dude. You don't have to, like, everybody's in this big pot of music doing their own thing. And, you know, when he would do stuff like that, it always annoyed me. Because I was into the more commercial sounding bands. And he had a lot of interest in, like, the heavier bands.
Right. And so I get that. And it's his show, and he gets to do what he wants. And I was totally into it. But I myself, well, if we would have put a video out of a song called Crying Shame, less margin to make fun of it.
Yeah.
Even if you didn't like it. You know what I'm saying?
That's wrong too.
So you shouldn't go, what could you say to that? You'd have to go, well, that's a pretty cool sounding title, cool sounding name of the band. The band's live and everything. You can't really make fun of it.
Yeah.
If you were going to do that, that was my thought of it. But, you know, what do I know? I didn't have a $1 million TV show that, you know, played all the, you know, whatever you wanted to play. But that's,
well, you know, you know how Ricky Rackman got that job, right? From his buddy Axel. Axel Rose went into MTV and said, here, hire this guy. And of course, at that time, MTV wasn't going to say no to Axel Rose.
So, right, of course. You know, brings him more people, more money, more revenue, more everything. So we'll try this guy out and da 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 da, and they put him on a, you know, Headbangers Ball, and you know you're going to get X amount of people that watch it, and they're going to try to appeal to even more, and then they'll bring some new bands, and then put the old classics, and they'll, you know, it's all corporate.
Yeah.
Shit.
Yeah.
If I may.
Yeah. No.
Yeah.
What's interesting though is Ricky Rackman's going to be here, near me in Lakewood, Ohio, on December 7th, I believe, doing like a storyteller kind of thing where he's...
Yeah, I saw something like that. Yeah.
Yeah. I may go and check that out.
I'm sure he probably has a shit ton of really cool stories.
He did a podcast last year.
Right. Go just to hear the crazy stories that he probably has known about or been involved in or whatever. Absolutely. So that's all part of, you know, It's all part of the thing of life. Whether you make millions of dollars or you don't, everybody's got a story to tell. So just depends on who's interested in it or not, you know.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, I don't necessarily I wish Headbanger's Ball would have been a little bit different, where it seemed like, I don't know, it did focus on a lot of underground heavier bands. I wish the more, like, whatever, for lack of a better term, the hair metal bands would have gotten a little better treatment on some of that, because, I mean, let's face it, that's, to me, that's where the talent was. That's where everything was just coming out. And I mean, as a kid, I loved the energy of the music.
Right.
I liked some of the thrash bands, and I was into some of the heavier stuff, but that stuff didn't even compare to the energy of guys like you guys and the Poisons and the Motleys. Right. I mean, it's just a totally different type of energy.
I think that they had kind of no choice. They had to like balance it because it was being called Headbanger's Ball.
Yep.
So right. They had said Air Metal's Ball. You would have gotten away with more like I See White Lion Behind You and all of the different, you know, all of those bands were really, really great, I felt, throughout the 80s and into the very beginning of the 90s. But once it got labeled and classified as hair metal, you couldn't have Headbanger's Ball and not put Exodus and Anthrax and all of those kinds of bands to counter it, or else people would go, well, all we see all day or all show long is just a bunch of dudes with wild, crazy hair, you know, whatever.
So, dancing around.
Exactly. So I think what they tried to do is they tried to do a balance, because I do remember them playing bands like us. And I don't know if you guys remember a band called Child's Play.
Mm-hmm.
Went out with them for like a month or so. I remember they played their video. They were new. You know, just different other things along the same lines, but they couldn't just do it in one thing or else people would bitch and complain.
Yeah.
Oh, you're playing too much heavy shit. How come you don't play stuff that girls like or whatever? Then if you go the other way, how come you're playing all this foo-foo shit? I want to hear some, you know, badass shit. It's, you can't win.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can't. And there was always, you know, it was always like people like me, even in school, man, I would be like in school and I'd be friends with the heavy thrasher guys, and I was friends with all the girls because they loved the music that I loved. But I also knew, you know, I could hold my own talking about Anthrax or talking about Slayer, bringing those bands.
You know, why be labeled?
Yeah, that's exactly. Where
the problem is, you know, at the end of the 60s and then through the 70s, they might have come up with heavy metal. But the reality of it is you could have everything from Black Sabbath to Led Zeppelin to Grand Funk Railroad to Styx to REO to Foreigner to this through the 70s, and everybody got along and everybody liked it and it was great. Then all of a sudden, why do you got to have thrash stuff? Why do you got to have alternative stuff? Why do you got to have hair metal stuff? Why don't you just say it's just a different style of music? Put it all together. Everybody, you know.
And I never understood why couldn't bands like you guys or any of those, you know, Poisons, Motleys, all that stuff coexist with Nirvana and Soundgarden? They weren't that far off.
Exactly.
Where did we get introduced to Soundgarden or Alice in Chains or even Pearl Jam? All of them got played on Headbanger's Ball.
Correct.
All of them. You could go back and you can see it. All of them got played. And they were getting played on 120 minutes, but you sure as fuck weren't seeing White Lion wait on 120 minutes.
Correct.
You know, but so, I mean, it was.
Yeah. And
definitely pushed.
It's not like it was some grassroots, like uprising, like the grunge stuff, right? I remember a couple of months ago, I was talking with another, the guy from the band Paradise on here on the show, and Adam, And he was saying that he himself was in a meeting with Rob Cavallo, the guy that produced Green Day and all of that. Mm-hmm. And this guy told them, hey, you guys are on the way out. The sound of this was 88, and he said the sound of the 90s is not you guys. So you either change your sound and your band name, or you're dead. And he told me this little funny thing that he picked up a random demo out of his desk, and it turned out to be Winger's second album on demo. And he said, you know, this is not gonna make it. This is some. I give them one more album and that's it. So it's not like of course there's an element of people searching for something new, something exciting, but there was also always a big push by the labels and the media to get that new style of music, like to be the new hot thing.
Right.
As well.
And I think in more recent times, I think that's a lot of the reason why bands or artists have found ways to do it without record company labels.
Right.
The reality of it is you get distribution, you get your own people together. There's enough people in this world that could like all sorts of different kinds and types of music. So you don't have to label nothing. You know, Nirvana's here. Well, Generation Landslide's here. Okay, well, Slaughter's here and Poison's here. It doesn't make difference. The reality is when someone puts something on, you sit and go, wow, I like that. Or, nah, I'm not a really big fan. Well, what was it? Well, oh, that was thrash. Don't you know? Well, what difference does it make if you like something or don't like something of what it is? You either like it or you don't. So you cut the record labels out, and they're the ones who are sitting going, oh, look, the latest thing is Donna Summer. Man, we got to have four other bands that are like Donna Summer because this is a new disco, you know. And then everybody goes into the disco mode. You know what I'm saying? It's like you don't have to do that anymore. You just believe in what you believe in. You get enough people to enjoy it, and there you go. You know, right. You take the label right out of it.
And that's definitely the internet has helped with that, with people being able to find, you know, whatever that is they want to listen to. And and it's I believe it's also a big reason why there's somewhat of a resurgence of the glam scene and the hard rock scene. You have, you know, the M3 Festival, you have Monsters on the Mountain, you have the Monsters of Rock Cruise. I mean, obviously, people still want to hear that style of music. Correct. But then you have bands coming out of like Sweden, bands like Crazy Licks and Heat, who are doing that style of music with a nice modern twist to it.
Correct.
And it's awesome. It's awesome to see.
And that's where you see, you just hit on what the whole back to, not trying to promote my thing, but that's what I tried to hit on. What you're saying right there is exactly what I'm trying to do on this record. Is you're going to hear stuff on, oh God, it sounds familiar, but you can't place it. But it also has a modern twist to it. That's the whole point, that if everything sounded like Motley Crue, it wouldn't work. If everything sounded like Led Zeppelin, it wouldn't work. But if you take the overall style of what you got going on those videos, anything through the end of the 70s, the 80s, the beginning of the 90s, and put your own little modern spin on it.
Mm-hmm.
It's about the songs is what it really comes down to. And you can play festivals and do things like M3 Fest and stuff where they're going to get a bunch of different same type of things, but different. So everybody can enjoy all sorts of different types of stuff. That's the whole key to everything right there, really.
And
it also, and staying true to what you want to do is also something that people tend to favor, like something that sounds real, sounds authentic. It doesn't sound like like, right. I don't know, like fake, right? I mean, if not, if you were having a more modern twist on your music, also makes it more real. I mean, you're not a 20 something with hairspray and spandex anymore, right?
You have to do different.
You'll end up being Steel Panther otherwise.
Right. Nobody is going to reinvent the wheel anymore. There's right. no such thing anymore. But what you can do is don't wear spandex and don't put your hair up. You see what I'm saying? You could still have the same type of music, but as long as you don't look like Poison or Vixen, how's anybody going to know?
Yeah. It's all rock and roll.
Rock and roll. Yeah.
It's all it's been for all those years, you know. Then all of a sudden labels come along and everybody's got to have a label and a this and a that. And everybody has to grow their hair like this. And everybody has to wear this. And everybody has to look like this. And da-da-da. You know.
Yeah, it's so crazy.
And it's funny that the labels, 9 times out of 10, relate more to the look than it does yes.
of course.
And that's
people hear with their eyes. It's always been a proven fact that, you know, that's just the way it's always been. You know, if you see something that blows you away, all of a sudden you see a guy get up there and he blowing fire. Oh my God, that's going to be the greatest thing in the world. Well, do you know anything about their music? Well, I don't need to yet. I'll worry about that later, but that was badass. Yeah. That's what starts it.
That's another thing.
So different. I was just gonna say. I mean, I guess we're all guilty of that in a way. I mean, when you find a new album and I don't know, it has a fucking big, four guys in spandex and says something, I don't know, band title or something like that, Steel Badger or something like that, and so you're gonna buy that album because you. It ticks off all the right things, right? It makes in a world without the internet, it makes even more sense that you're gonna go with the image and the band name and the whatever that fits the style. Right.
You know what I did that to? Yeah. The one band I did that to, I have to be honest and admit, I walked into a record store, had to have been 80. Trying to think of when it came out. I'm going to go with 84, 85. No, 86. I'm sorry. You guys will know once I say who it is. I'm going to say 86. Walked into the record store and this and that and the other. And I picked up this album. And I saw these four guys standing on this alley. And just all this, that, and the other. And the name of the band was Cinderella. And I looked and I went, oh my God, this is freaking cool as hell. Less than a week later, after seeing that record, I was living in California at the time and they were coming. I said, I've got to go and see them just to see. This is crazy. I went and saw them. I was so blown away by them. I thought they were one of the greatest new bands to come out. Bought the record, blah, 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 blah. And I've always been a Cinderella fan. But the point is, look how they look. Look at the name of the band.
Right.
You can immediately sit and go, oh my God, who are these guys? And what kind of a stupid name is that? But the reality of it was, it caught your interest. You went and saw them live and you just went, whoa, these guys are freaking awesome. I don't care if they're called Cinderella or Cindafella. It doesn't matter. They were freaking cool.
Yeah.
Only times in my life I ever did that, and I thought, wow, this is what it's like, you know.
yeah. My moment like that was with Poison. So I before I got into all the glam stuff, hard rock stuff, I was a big Iron Maiden fan. I'm more of the more heavier classic stuff, right? So I remember reading this magazine that recalled, I don't know, new hard rock, whatever, and they were talking about Poison. So Poison, what's that? And the name caught my interest, right? And they were talking about this song Fallen Angel, and I went on and searched for that song. I was immediately blown away, like you said, by the video, like the whole yep. image, the sound yep. was so different to stuff that I've been listening to. So, right. And yeah, I mean, it's all, it got to me through the band picture, the photo of them and all that glammed up image of them and the name and the logo.
But then it becomes a label. Do you see that? What you just said and what I said. So you're taking Cinderella and you're taking Poison. After they became big, they became a label.
Right.
Do you see what I'm saying? Why did it become a label? Oh my God, you're into glam metal, glam rock because you like Cinderella and Poison. No, I just thought they were cool looking and I thought their music was good. It had nothing to do with, you right, know, yeah. I have to this and this and this.
Never thought about it.
Right?
Never thought about it. Whenever I bought an album, I never thought, oh, I'm buying a glam record.
Right.
So to me, I'm buying a rock album. You know, that was it. Because I mean, when you can go
band out.
Yeah, you right. can go. You could start with The Sweet. You could start with Kiss. You could start with any of those. Even David Bowie. They were all glammed out. They did their. They had the big show. Alice Cooper. All of them.
Yep.
Then you could just go down the line. Def Leppard weren't all glammed out.
Nope.
They never were. But people nope. say, oh, they were a glam band. No, well, right, technically, right. no, they were not. They were not. A new wave of British heavy metal band is what they were.
Correct.
But they didn't look like The Sweet.
Nope.
They were fans of The Sweet, but they didn't look like them. Correct. Or like, you know, it's so funny. People like will swear to me like, man, Guns N' Roses aren't a glam band. Really? Have you looked at the early? If you want to go by glam.
Yeah,
look at the early pictures of Guns N' Roses.
Beginning pictures of them, same thing.
But once again, it's yep. the look, not the yep. sound.
Right.
And
that's what it is. But when you listen to it, that's what's funny about it. When you just listen to it and don't look at anything, a good song's a good song. A good album is a good album, yep. and a good band is a good band. So yep. it doesn't make any bit of difference. You could say you like this guy and this guy and this guy because he looks this and this. Well, there's other guys that don't look like that still play good and write good songs and are in good bands. So why are you judging? The only judgment that I feel that people should judge is the material itself. What does the material do to you? Do you like it? Does it make you feel some way or something? Or it's just not something I care for. Why? Because they look funny. Take that out of it. And just close your eyes and put something on and go, do you like it or don't like it? And if you do, then take a look and go, wow, that was bad.
That's how they look.
If,
you know what band really got kind of fucked over by all that was Enough's Enough. I thought their music was.
I mean, look, Donny V to me was a modern day John Lennon.
Yes.
In my mind, that first Enough's Enough, even the second Enough's Enough album,
which was phenomenal.
There's some brilliant stuff on there, amazing stuff on there. Stop looking at what they look like and just listen to the songs and you will hear it. Wow, that sounds different. Yeah, because he was a big Beatles fan.
Yeah.
Well, the Beatles didn't have all whatever, you see? But
Enough's Enough really didn't either. If you go to that first album, look at the back sleeve. Look at that picture on the back sleeve. That was Enough's Enough.
Yes.
I believe it was Donnie that was talking about that when they did those first couple videos. They were like, you know, what is this, you know? And
they were a peace hippie band.
Yeah.
Love and all that other stuff. And then somehow or another, someone said, oh, they're just a glam band.
Yeah, just glam them up and here you go.
And that's it.
Yeah.
Right.
It's been that way for a long time. And I know that I was part of it at the end part of the 80s and the early 90s and stuff. And I felt the same way and same thing because everybody did what they felt they did in their look or how the band wanted to be perceived. But it had nothing to do with the music. The material is all on its own, you know. But
yeah, people like to like compartmentalize stuff so much. Like, yes. If you don't like to this sound, this look, you're not true metal. And if you do like it, but not in the same way that I like it, then you're not true metal. And whatever, right? And I think it is some. For example, here in Argentina, back in the 90s, you were either a Queen fan or Kiss fan. I don't know why, but there was like that dichotomy, right? You were either Kiss fan or Queen fan. So, and if you liked Queen, there was no way you could like Kiss, because otherwise people would just shun you.
Because they were nowhere near the same type of band. Not even close.
So, but for some reason, someone decided that was the dichotomy that everyone should abide by, right? So, and I think in a way, and nowadays it is pretty similar in that way. I mean, people like to classify themselves as, I'm a Metallica fan. I won't listen to some poser.
I think those kind of people don't realize that if you're such a big Metallica fan, you would know that the members in Metallica liked these types of bands,
right? And if
you like those types of bands, you would not say you're only a Metallica fan then, because the bands that they liked were Raven, Angel Witch, all of these kinds of bands like that you go, oh well, I'm a Metallica fan, I'm not going to listen to that stuff. Well, they did, but you don't even know it, you know?
That's how I I absolutely love the music all around, and every time a band would cover somebody else's song, I always checked out the original, always.
Absolutely.
If I wasn't familiar with it, sure, I wanted to hear, you know, when Metallica did the Budgie song, I went back and checked those guys out.
Nobody knew who Budgie was.
No, I didn't.
But it was big from Metallica. Here's another one, Whiskey in the Jar. People didn't, who knew Thin Lizzy did it? Who? Well, you don't even check? I mean,
you know what? I knew of Thin Lizzy, but... what was that song they did? It's funny because I didn't even No. It was Dedication. That was the song. Dedication.
Okay. Oh, Dedication, which was a later thing
together. I love that song. With him. That's the song that got me into Thin Lizzy. I didn't even realize they did Boys Are Back in Town.
Yeah. See?
I didn't even realize, you know. And then I go back and you listen to it and it's like, it's a totally different world. You know, it's great. I mean, just hear White Lion doing Radar Love.
Yep.
You know, I went back and I listened to Golden Earring, you know, because of that.
Golden Earring was another great band. Everybody thinks they're a one-hit wonder, but they had a lot of great songs. But people don't know it because people don't want to take the time to find out where music comes from. It comes from somewhere before it. You can't sit and say Guns N' Roses or Metallica invented everything.
We all know Motley Crue did.
Yeah, right. That's another one. So Motley Crue puts Helter Skelter or whatever you know, and all of a sudden, you know, it's big and popular. Well, where's the Beatles? You know what I'm saying? It's like everybody tries to put that label in that whole, this is my band and this is my, there's a lot of good bands, there's a lot of great music, and there's always been that, but don't put labels on it and just enjoy it.
I always
thought it was all just rock and roll. I don't know, it's not just, I mean, all these labels. I agree with you guys.
Aerosmith's a little frustrated right now. Yeah.
Hey, Aerosmith said it best. You got to let the music do the talking.
Absolutely.
Exactly. Yeah.
Absolutely. You could go around and around and around and around forever. But the reality at the end of the day is when you put something on your turntable or your cassette player or your CD player or whatever it is that you're doing, and if it moves you, it doesn't matter who it is, from Bay City Rollers to Metallica. It doesn't make any difference.
Hey, Bay City Rollers have some great songs.
Great songs.
We love those guys, man.
Once again, they were labeled. So yeah. Who are they? Oh, they're nobody. They're nothing. Well, yeah. You'd be surprised. Yeah.
I recently bought one of their later albums on vinyl. I think it's called, what is it called? I don't know, but Wind something. It's from like the late 70s. I think it was the last one they released. And the music is so complex and it's so good. And it's not just, it's not just some poppy teen bopper stuff. It's so good.
But that's what they want to sell you.
Yeah.
So definitely, it works. Yeah. They've been doing this money-making cash cow machine for...
I will admit this. I haven't listened to much of the Bay City Rollers.
But that...
I use them
as an example, meaning one extreme to another is really what I'm saying. It's like it really makes no difference. A good song is a good song. When people realize, like, someone like Carole King wrote this song and that song and da da da, oh my god, those were huge. Well, what difference does it make? Does it matter if it's a band or an art? You know, you stop worrying about one little aspect of it, of how they look or how the this and the other, and just listen to it and go, that's a cool song, I dig it, right on, move on to the next.
The other day I was listening to the Back to the Lazy River by the fucking Osmonds. dude, if you put an electric guitar in the background, that's a fucking Faster Pussycat song. It has the same structure.
Which one was it?
Now what you're doing there is, all you're doing is just different time frame. So you could take a song like that, put what you said in it, and you've just literally taking it from the 70s to the 80s.
Right.
And then you could turn around and put something else in it, like say double bass drums or harder drums on it. You've moved it into the 90s.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? But it's still the same structure. It's still the same. A song is a good song is a good song.
A song is a good song, definitely.
That's all I got to say on that. So,
okay.
Wow, so we really got into that, didn't we?
Stellar, right?
All right. So that's a good segue, actually. So we always like to wrap up the episodes with a little top three favorite albums. So I'm gonna put you on the spot and ask you, what are yours?
Three is cutting it pretty slim.
We can do five. We can do five. If
you always alter it. You're like, well, we can do
not any particular order.
Albums, or you can do five albums, or
that's the magic of the podcast. Order,
but if I had to pick three records that I could listen to front and back, day and night, for the rest of my life or whatever, I would pick Aerosmith Rocks.
Nice.
I would pick Led Zeppelin Physical Graffiti. I would pick Ted Nugent Free For All.
Okay, interesting.
Now, I know they're all old. I know they're dated. But something about those three particular records, they give me everything that I need as far as anything. Drums, guitar, singing, songwriting, titles, album covers, everything about it, it's the full package for me. I could be good with just those, but that's tough because I did a top 10, I was asked one time, and those were three of them. And it was tough to just do just three because I had some other really good ones on there.
Yeah, we did an episode, our top 10 albums of 89, and that was a pain. Oh, we ended up having how many different, what were they like?
Like 15 outtakes, like runner-ups.
that's tough to do, you know? I mean,
Yeah.
Everybody's got their personal favorites, I guess, according to mood, you know, because then I could switch gears. And I could literally tell you guys right now, okay, strike those three. Let's go on a different thing. I would pick Iron Maiden, Number of the Beast, and I'd pick Judas Priest, Stay in Class. Now, I'd pick those first three that were classic rock, but I could pick those two other ones that are hard, you know, they're still freaking great records. I mean, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
You can't deny that, but they're two completely different genres, but not really.
Yeah. Yeah, because my love of music started with Rick Springfield.
And that's right.
I still love Rick Springfield to this day. He is my rock and roll idol.
Those first three records he did are excellent. I love those first three records Rick Springfield did. I would admit.
You're talking about the 80s records?
Yeah.
You're talking about, because don't forget, he had a bunch of albums out before that.
Yeah, I know, but I never heard any of the later stuff. I'm just literally going off of like the initial first couple that everybody says, oh, it's just Jesse Girls and that's it.
No.
Have you heard the record other than Jesse's Girl?
He's not a one-hit wonder by any means whatsoever.
Right?
No, not at all.
I was just having this conversation with somebody. I can't remember who I was having it with. It might have been Dave Tedder. We were talking about this, and someone was, getting a gig with Rick Springfield or something, and he's kind of upset or kind of not all, oh, man, it's Rick Springfield. God, I mean, I don't know if I should be playing in that. And when he told me that, I said, is he crazy? Do you have any idea how big Rick Springfield is? The places that he'll be playing and the songs that he'll have to learn are great. I mean, wow.
Yeah.
But, you know, once again, good songs are good songs.
Good songs are good songs.
So, good songs are good. And that's a great motto to close with. Good songs are good songs.
Definitely. Good songs are good songs. Don't mean much, but you know.
Yeah. All right.
It's a lot to us.
all right. So Anthony, thanks. Thank you so much for being on the show. You've been great. We love talk. I feel like we could talk for hours, and we did. So
thanks for having me. I do appreciate it.
It was awesome. And hey, you're now a friend of the show. So whenever you want to come back, promote any new stuff you got going on, or whatever, or just hang out. you are always welcome.
I do appreciate it. Thank you guys very much. It's really nice to meet both of you guys.
Anthony, thank you so much, man. It's an honor.
Thank you, too. Take care of you guys.
Okay.
Thank you.
You too, man.
Bye, man.
Bye.
Take care. Bye.